Tonight we have Lynne Stewart, and it's really an honor. It's a big deal for us. Lynne is somebody that we've always wanted to have come speak here, and because of circumstances, both legal and physical, you know, we didn't know if it was ever... Yes, and both. We didn't know if it was ever going to happen, and, you know, the stars have aligned and we have Lynne, so let's give her a big buffalo welcome.
When I hear all the announcements, I know it's spring, because everybody says at endless meetings in February, which, as Clark Kissinger once said to me, the price of liberty is endless meetings. But in February, they all say, well, we better wait till April. We better wait to schedule that till April or May, the season for getting out there and protesting. And I must say that while in some ways it saddens me, in other ways, I can say that things that I have fought long and hard for all my life, I'm still fighting for. They're still out there to be fought for, still worth fighting for. And as I, of course, as an ex-librarian, which I was for 10 years of my life in the New York City schools before I became a lawyer, I'm very much at home in a bookshop. And I feel that for many of us, there's somewhere hidden deep in the recesses of our heart, the notion of having a bookstore and being in a bookstore all day and having interesting people coming in to buy books and to sell books and to talk about books and all of those things. So, and as I walked around the room earlier, I did feel there's so much of what has been my life all these past years in this very room on the shelves. Just amazing. I see there's a Sacco and Vanzetti DVD, which reminds me of when I was a teenager and just sort of getting, how would you say, the awakenings, the buds blooming. You know, when I would read Edna St. Vincent Millay's poems about how they killed Sacco and Vanzetti. And then I keep going and I see from my early legal career, I see there's a CD, I guess it is, of Robert Williams, who when I was in the 60s, just a foot soldier in the move for change, but oh, what a glorious, glorious time that was. And Ralph, my husband, and I both, he was the leadership in the struggle for community control of schools, a magic thing which has seemed in some new life has been blown into it. People are talking community control. We think they are biting off a big bite if they think they can get community control of police. But we thought, and we still think, and we will fight on for probably ever, that community control of schools in the big cities is not such a big bite and really would have gone in those days and today a long way towards resolving not only racial problems in the schools, or what should I say? I shouldn't say racial problems, but the issue of race in the schools as well as jobs, because it's controlling a piece of the community's economics. And by controlling that piece of economics, you are able to then call some of the shots. And as Ralph is so fond of saying, a community where there are no jobs, of course there has got to be the pipeline to the state prisons. So, as I say, I was on my way, someone told me that there was a new book out on solitary confinement, and that it had a reading or an opening at the Center for Constitutional Rights in New York, and they sold out every copy they had. It was such a big hit. So I see that Leslie as only Leslie can, has copies of it over there down on the end of one shelf. And of course, this was a great victory for which we probably don't take enough credit, and I talk about the victory at Pelican Bay. And the fact that starting with a convict's, in quote, writ of habeas corpus, who started an action in the courts and interested a young lawyer who has gone on now to be the lawyer for Mumia Abu-Jamal, and I speak of Brett Grody, they were actually able to prevail. And as I say, this was a jailhouse lawyer, this was his writ, and this was broke the back of the kind of solitary confinement that there was at Pelican Bay, and maybe in other parts of the country as well. And as I say, and Brett went on, now he's part of the, is it the abolition law firm, Ralph?
I'm not sure.
I'm not positive, but it's in Pennsylvania, and its association with Sobel, who is an old-time lefty lawyer practicing out of Pittsburgh, not too far from you. And it was one of those things where Brett went out to talk to the young man who had written the petition out in California in the hellhole of Pelican Bay. And after talking to him, he went back to Sobel and said, I don't care what else we do, we got to fight this one because this is so good. They have done such good work. And they did fight it and they did win it. And California is now agreed to delimit solitary confinement in major ways. So there's not many victories out here, but there are some. I know I stand before you as one of them.
Yeah.
This is all our victories. And of course, I have to thank the good Ralph, my dear Ralph, because he was the one, and he traveled many times to Buffalo to get people to sign the petitions, to get people to be aware, to be kept alive, me and where I was, which was in another bad place, in Dallas, Texas. Prison is bad, but prison in Texas is somehow even badder, and although I cannot compare it to places like Huntsville, the real Texas prisons. This is a federal prison, and it has, just for your own little storehouse of information, there is a separate building that nobody in the main prison, which I was in, seems to know very much about, but it's where they hold people, women. It is the women's equivalent of Florence, Florence being the maximum security prison. And they are holding in that prison, which is a separate building and where nobody comes or goes, where there is no interaction with the prison population. And into this death camp, they have placed Marius Mason, person who you may know from the Earth First struggles and who was responsible in the past for liberating animals at the University of Michigan and burning down a couple of labs as doing so. Also in there is another person you may not have heard of, and that's Ana Belen Montes. Ana has served 15 years. She is in a really repressive situation where she does not get mail. She does not send mail. She does not have visitors except her immediate family, most of whom are not interested in visiting her. She is in prison for espionage. Whoa, espionage. Well, what was her espionage? She was a very highly placed person in the defense intelligence circles. I'm not sure the name where it was in government. But she was made part because of her background, her ethnicity, her fact she was born in Puerto Rico. She was made part of a number of what would you say, groups that visited Cuba. And while she was there, she became convinced that the American policy toward Cuba was not only wrong, but it was harmful. It was harmful to this country as well as to Cuba. And so she began passing secrets. She was very brave, and she was caught, and they basically, in the true nature of plea bargaining, sort of held her over a barrel and said, well, you know, you can get the death penalty for this, but if you plead guilty, we're just going to give you 25 years, and 25 years in a solitary confinement. So Anna, just recently, I'm very proud to have been asked to join a group, a committee, to free Anna. She has been in jail for 15 years, and supposedly this country just wants to be friends with Cuba. Although, who was it that said they want to smother? Who was it? Was that Oscar Lopez? Anyway, one of the prisoners said that by becoming friendly, they want to envelop Cuba in a large hug that will ultimately smother them and smother the idealism and smother everything else. But people are always asking me, what do you think Assad's chances are with Cuba? And I have faith that the Cuban people and the Cuban government can never, ever betray the trust that she showed, and ultimately that our movement showed by delivering Assad to Cuba, one of the great heroes of our time. So anyway, so that's another name, Ana Belen Montes, that's was part of my background and etc. But of course we're all caught up because we're almost forced to be caught up in presidential politics. I said to someone, I didn't vote or pay taxes for 20 years, and I'm not going to start now. But anyway, I do want to say that in 2004, we figured out it was, right, at a guild convention, I was speaking, and I spoke about it was the closing day of the convention, and I said that we were leaving to go back to do our tasks, to fight on. And one of the things I said was that we face I can find it here in this old speech. I likened our quest to those that I always read about to my kids and when I was a librarian, but then when I was a grandmother, I still am a grandmother, and my own kids, the great folk and tales and hero tales, and I don't mean Captain America. I do say that here, I mentioned that it was an election year, and that was the election year, as I say, 2004 did we decide it was? And I said that we are facing an election. And we can count on the media to hype whatever the results are. Whatever it is, they will hype it to suit themselves. The only thing I think that we watch with some interest in this particular election is the fact that it would seem that if Trump doesn't get his way, if he's not nominated on the front burner, on the first ballot or whatever, he may finally, or he may in a fit of pique, which he seems to be very good at, take on the notion of how these conventions operate, of what our primary is all about, of who picks the candidates. Because ultimately, you know, that is really what a democracy has to be about. It's who are the candidates that are put in front of you to vote for? And of course, if that is totally controlled, and we have no reason to believe it is anything but totally controlled, then there is no choice. Then you are constantly being asked to choose between evil and less evil, or bad and worse, or so I look at that aspect of the presidential with some interest, but I must say that in reading over the speech the other day, I said that we are people, most of us in this room, who are summoned into this struggle to change the world. We are hoping, we are working, we are trying to do something in our daily lives so that change will come. And I said it at that time, and I repeat it again, because for me it is so important that I'm just going to read just a short bit of it. Ralph loves this, and many times of an evening he will say, read the speech again. And I will say, oh, not that, you're embarrassing me, why are you doing this? But I read it, and it is very nice. And I say, so I'm going to inflict it on you. I know he'll be happy. And in the middle it goes on. We have formidable enemies, not unlike those in the tales of ancient days. There is a consummate evil that unleashes its dogs of war on the helpless, an enemy motivated only by insatiable greed. The miller's daughter made to spin gold, the fisherman's wife, Midas, all with no thought of consequences. In this enemy, there is no love of the land or the creatures that live there, no compassion for the people. This enemy will destroy the air we breathe and the water we drink as long as the dollars keep filling their money boxes. We now resume our everyday lives, but we have been charged again with and for our quests, just like, and then I made a long list, Goliath, Beowulf, and then I dare mention Ho and Mao and Lenin, Fidel, Nelson Mandela, the younger, not the older, and John Brown, Che Guevara, who reminds us, at the risk of seeming ridiculous, let me say that the true revolutionary is guided by great feelings of love. Our quests, like theirs, are to shake the very foundations of the continents. We go out to stop police brutality, to rescue the imprisoned, to change the rules for those who have never even been able to get to the starting line, much less run the race, because of color, physical condition, gender, mental impairment. We go forth to preserve the air and land and water and sky and all the beasts that crawl and fly. We go forth to safeguard the right to speak and write, to join, to learn, to rest safe at home, to be secure, fed, healthy, sheltered, loved, and loving, to be at peace with one's identity. We have a peasant poisonous government that spreads its venom to the body politic in all corners of the globe. We have big war. In those days I said big war in Iraq, I guess I better say Syria. Big war in Afghanistan, smaller wars in Colombia, Central Africa, Southeast Asia. How little it all changes. We have detainees and political prisoners at home. And now looming in 2004, we have those Democratic and Republican conventions, and then an election with the corporate media ready to hype the results and drown out the righteous protests. But we are the people of the cities and towns. We are the people who do the get out there, get on the bus to Albany, go downtown for bombs, not, no, go downtown for food, not bombs. See, I sometimes get mixed up about those things, but that's all right. That's, just don't tell my parole officer. So I'm going to bring a couple of more little tidbits that I just want to share with you. One of them is another political prisoner that maybe not many of you know is Tom Manning. Tom Manning comes from South Boston, the worst of Southies, white, Irish, working class, brought up to hate gays, brought up to hate blacks. And Tom went in the Navy and got shipped off to Vietnam and learned and ultimately joined up with a group known as the United Freedom Front, who fought for many things, but among them, and most importantly, for the end of apartheid for South Africa. All of them have served time. It's only Tom and Jan Lahman, who is actually from Buffalo, Tonawanda, I believe he's from. Jan, this is. And but at any rate, Tom is still in jail. He's at Butner. Butner is a medical, and I use those terms in quotations, just like we call them prisons, but we really should call them all death camps, because that is truly what they are. And I stole that from my husband, but at any rate, but I just got this day before yesterday from the Jericho folks, and Lamb in particular, and I want to read it because it's from Tom. He's at Butner, and just to give you an idea about prison medicine, of which I know a great deal, having been taken for chemotherapy in shackles and cuffs, escorted by two heavyweight corrections officers were loaded with 9mm, and that didn't bother me so much as the fact that they not only had the nines, but they must have had two belts of ammo. I thought to myself, good grief. But anyway, they were gonna make sure that this dangerous lady going in for chemo treatments for her cancer did not escape. I might have felt bad if they hadn't treated me like that. I would have felt, my God, maybe I wasn't doing such a great job. But at any rate, that was then. But Tom, he's had trouble. He's had problems with bone things and whatever, and he's now at Butner. When he was at the Springfield Medical, I just want to give you one little tidbit to show you what medical care is like in prison. He went in to have an operation on his ankle, I believe it was. It may have been his knee. But at any rate, when he came out of the operating room and finally got on his feet, one leg was about 2 or 3 inches shorter than the other. So he said, what about this? What's going on here, you know? So they said to him, and they'll say this with a straight face, and not be afraid that it'll be repeated, but they said to him, that's okay. When we do the other one, we'll even it up.
Thanks.
Anyway, Tom is still great. I'm going to read you a letter that he wrote a minute after midnight in this cell. He's at Butner. That's in South Carolina, North Carolina, one of those. I'm terrible. One of those Carolinas, those not so great places. Anyway, here's what he wrote. A minute after midnight in this cell, reading Ramsey Baroud's March 17th piece on the BDS boycott of the Zionists who occupy Palestine and slaughter Palestinians at will. I watch TV in here, this prison hospital, a lot, and see what the American public is fed and accept passively every day. Things that seem minor to my fellow captives when I mention it, which I do. They look at me as if I'm the TV grouch. The blonde actress Jorgensen, who is pro-Zionist factories in the West Bank of Palestine, she's a superhero in Captain America, the movie. An Israeli soldier who plays Wonder Woman in Wonder Woman in another superhero movie, who gets more interview time than the Palestinian family whose son was shot in the head by an Israeli soldier while laying on the ground under arrest. Bang! Big joke. I see a news clip. It shows two men, a father and son maybe, tending their fishing gear on a beach with the open sea beyond. Open. The Zionists have just allowed Palestinians of Gaza to fish 9 miles out. The limit had been 6 miles. While I take in this view, I have the visual memory of the four boys in a tight athletic group running this way and that, trying unsuccessfully to outrun the bursting shells the Zionists are lobbing at them from out on that same sea. Then CBS Evening News shows us the young men of Gaza who do some amazing acrobatic jumping and tumbling amidst the ruins of their city, looking for moments of freedom when their feet are off the ground between leaping and landing. And as the American reporter interviews them for the little news novelty moment at the end of the evening, we can see the shining ribbon of prison apartheid wall in the background, from one side of the TV screen to the other, with the very high-tech, highly lethal watchtower, God Tower, shining against the blue sky. I try to focus my fellow captives on the real stories behind this diversionary propaganda. Try to explain apartheid and how it can be applied in places other than South Africa. When asked, how do you know all this shit? I tell them I'm here in this prison with them for fighting against apartheid. I can't capture the Abbott and Costello-like conversation that grew out of this. And as I left the TV room, I heard someone say, that motherfucker's crazy. And someone else says, what time's the game on? That's from Tommy Manning, locked up, probably going to stay locked up unless we do something about it. Unless we get ourselves organized just as you did for me, we have got to organize ourselves behind, what is it, 200 political prisoners still behind the walls? We have got to bring them home. We can't call ourselves a movement if we don't. We must do this. This is our, in my view, prime objective, prime goal. It is what I will give the rest of my life to doing. We've organized, we finally got the guild, not exactly the most radical of groups, but it is better than some. And we have organized now a committee that has been formed to organize lawyers, if they can herd cats. And I can say that as an ex-lawyer, but at any rate, because we want every political prisoner to have a lawyer. Why? Because they are so vulnerable. They are so vulnerable and they are all aging, aging terribly, and they have no one to turn to for the most part. No one that they can get on the phone and say, you know what, they said they'd fix my leg up the next time. They're really left in there helpless unless we get together and we do something for them. So, as I say, and I just ask that you pay attention to some of these. The Jericho websites are wonderful. The Anarchist Black Cross websites, equally so. And I see that one of the free items that they're handing out there is the ABC list of all the political prisoners with their addresses, their pictures, their birthdays, everything. You cannot imagine what it means to be in prison and get a postcard or a letter or a card from the outside. I tell you, when I was in jail, one of your own, I don't know if he's here tonight, I don't know if I'd recognize him if I saw him, a young man who was, he is here, there he is, okay, he's hiding back there. He wrote to me about all the doings down at the demonstration on bank ground. This ground belongs to us. You can't demonstrate here. And he kept me right up to date, and he told me what was happening in the courts, and what had happened at the arrest, and what had happened with the police. Now, you know, you say to yourself, it was like someone, the sun came up that day and shone right through my cell bars to get a letter like that, to be in touch, because one of the worst things, and I think you get this from Tom's letter, is that they're cut off from what matters most. That is the politics of the moment. They are powerless in there. And most of them are our elder statesmen. They are people who thought long and hard before they got in as deep as they did. They thought long and hard before they took the militant actions, before they got into a position where many people say, oh, they were just adventurers, oh, they were just premature Marxists. Now, what's it called? That's not right. What is it called? You know, there's a word for it. But and I see that, you know, Jaleel Montakim, who's held, 20 miles from here at Attica, his new book is out. And it's full of his essays and his writings, and he's worth reading. He's worth reading because here comes a man with a lot of plants. I feel like I'm back in Sunday school in early May when they used to give out little plants. But to get back to Jaleel, he is one of our true elder statesmen. And he has, you know, he's coming up once again for parole. He can never get parole because, quote, the nature of the crime. The police are very, very well organized, as we all know. They have websites which have letters up at all times to be signed off on by police saying, don't ever let this guy out. And those parole boards are mainly made up of ex-law enforcement people. And I just, for me, these are not just, you know, names or pictures in a pamphlet. These are real flesh and blood people, and they are the best. I cannot tell you, I say write a note and get a note back, or make a visit, because a visit to one of these folks, really, it makes you, it gives you the lift, it gives you the moment of really feeling like, you know, we can go out. I mean, here they are in jail all these times. These are not just nobodies. These are my friends. These are your friends. These are our comrades, our colleagues. And until we bring them home, we are not doing anything really substantial to change the way in which we live. And so I want to urge that upon you. There was also a recent attempt by a young Palestinian to kill himself while at Attica. They're holding a vigil on Monday. They do a vigil once a month in solidarity with all the Muslim prisoners. And I just say that there are some that are strong, like Jaleel, who can last 40 years, like Leonard, although I must say it breaks my heart when I hear Leonard say, Obama's the only hope I ever have of getting out. This good man, this innocent man, this Leonard, and I brought a few bumper stickers, this innocent man should have to rely on that, should be driven to saying that's the only hope there is. Anyway, let me not get over emotional. I just do want to say that some people can take prison and some people can't. And it's up, we have to all be somewhat mindful that we are the bulwark that maybe can get between people who give up and people who die in there and people who continue to fight back. So the person I'm mentioning, who they are doing the first Monday of every month they do a vigil outside the jail in Manhattan, the MCC, where I spent a year. And this is an Algerian-American, Ahmed Berhani, who tried to kill himself and is in a medically induced coma right now. He had been at Attica. He was one of those very many Muslims or Arabs or who have been, it's entrapment. It may not reach all the niceties of the legal definition. No one knows the legal definition better than I, but I tell you, but it is entrapment when these very sophisticated, trained people get in to a mosque and get young people who have absolutely nothing. And I can recommend also to you, if the film comes to Buffalo, and I'm going to urge Leslie to get it if he hasn't, may have done it already here. We saw it in Albany, the movie called Terror. Oh, yeah. And it's got T in parentheses, but you're pointing over there. Is there a DVD of it over there?
Yeah, it was shown.
Okay, well, it's terrific. I mean, it shows how it's done, how people are entrapped. But I want to say to everybody, I'm very happy to be in Buffalo. I was very happy receiving mail from Buffalo when I was in jail. And I really feel that we have got to get ourselves going again. I always end by saying that when I was in Berkeley one night, and it was pretty depressing. It was not a good time. What was that, about 2002, 2003, something? I had just been arrested, and somebody came up and put his arm around me and said, "You know, Lynn, in the 50s, we never thought the 60s were coming." In the 50s, we had petitions for the Rosenbergs, and they killed them. And we never knew that there would be an upheaval like the upheaval that took place in the 60s. So all I can say to you is, keep on scratching the ground, keep on getting out there. Go, and if you don't want to be civilly disobedient, be uncivilly disobedient. or even worse, maybe. But at any rate, keep the pressure on. Let them know we're not, it ain't all about Bernie Sanders. It's about a lot more closer to the grassroots and a lot bigger fight. So, as I say, I couldn't be happier than to be in Buffalo on a Thursday night, and it's raining. No, that's good. And I will ask Ralph, come on up. I'm going to ask you to get me a chair. Would you come up and speak for a few minutes? And give me... Because if anyone can tell you how to organize to bring someone home, this is the guy.
In for a few minutes, because I say we all do something different. We can all do something. And those of you who vote, I implore you, make it clear to the person you're voting for that they can't have your help until they help the people who helped us. And the people who helped us were the people of the 60s and 70s who knew what was coming and laid down their life to make it better. They had total faith that we would get them out. And as one of the political prisoners said, a faith that no religion can ever match.
Matula Shakur, recently turned down by the parole board, that was his line, that there's a faith among people in prison that cannot be matched by any religion.
She says it better.
We I just wanted to identify Matula.
And we must be clear, they are death camps, and the government understands perfectly what they're doing to people that they call political prisoners. And so I looked many years ago to see how many politicians we had in this country who recognized political prisoners, and I came up with five. And if you call yourself a person who is involved in the political system of America and give your vote to somebody who does not help those who help us, you betrayed yourself as well as the people who understood. And the people died in the death camps. And when I hear some of the great warriors who sat in those death camps for 20 years believing that we would get them out, saying, I'm about to give up, I feel like crying. But rather than cry, I come and I bother you and other people to say, please don't do that. Now myself...
Raise the issue.
No, I never believed in voting.
I'm sorry.
Doesn't happen that way. History tells me armed struggle. And I was fortunate enough to have lived in an age where there was not enough evidence to put me away.
You said enough.
I said enough. My lawyer, all right. I
got some others here.
There are people here who are as old as I am. They're almost as old as I am. You know the story of America, the Union, and what gains that were made. I come from Western Pennsylvania, near the Virginia border, West Virginia border. There were no gains that weren't made without a physical impetus into the struggle. And one of my early jobs in... Now I'm going to talk about the minor. Early, she has to teach me.
I know, I know too much of his story.
Anyway, I played ball. All my guys play ball. And I was throwing snowballs at trees. And a young white man came up to me and he says, you're George's boy. And I said, well, yes. And he says, you're pretty good. And I said, I like to think of that at 14 years old. And he says, I have a job for you. I know your dad. And he says, come to this hill. And I went to the hill and they had piled stones. And he says, when those trucks come down the highway, and he says, you put one.
There was a strike on, he neglected to mention.
In a foundry. You put a stone right through those windows. And when it slows down, we're going to get out. And they jumped on the trucks and turned them over. And then they burned them. And they won the strike. And one day, sitting at dinner, we had a knock on the door. And it was one of the guys. He says, I've come to thank you, tell my father, I've come to thank you for the effort your son put into the strike. And my father took me to union meetings ever since I was 5 years old. I understood. But my mother said, never mind thanking him for working against the management, against the company. In that factory, in that foundry, there was never a black employee. And so what are you union people going to do about that? And my older brother, who had returned from World War II, was the first black person who worked in that foundry. Wow. So what lessons did I learn? You can't talk about this stuff. This system has to be hurt. And there are people willing to hurt this system, but they're watching. And I remember one of the struggles in the schools in New York City, where in 1965, when the population, the school population, was 50 to 60% black and Latino, there were no principals. You couldn't be a principal. You couldn't be a stationary engineer.
Black and Latino.
If you were black or of color. You couldn't have a contract. You couldn't do any of that. And we fought. We didn't ask them. First we asked them. And then we fought to get this done. And it worked to a degree. Another lesson is nobody pays attention to you unless you're willing to act. And we do a terrible disservice. So those young people who are angry, and we say, if you fight for us, we're going to abandon you. We're going to leave you in prison, even though you served your sentence. And they ignore the fact that you have served your sentence and nobody is enraged. And I was talking...
I think you have to make that a little clearer. In other words, he's saying that the people who went to jail in the early 70s or the 80s, sweeps of the 80s, have been abandoned. They never thought that would happen. They thought, first of all, that we were going to win. We all thought that. But also that they would come home. And by not doing it, what then gives anybody an impetus to start a Black Panther Party, to start an organization such as that? Such as that.
As I say to you, there's a good reason why the unions are being crushed today. Because there's nothing to fear from the unions. There was a time when something was to be feared from the unions.
Corruption, Ralph.
Corruption.
Never forget that.
I remember, and I'm going to digress a little, when Lynne was being punched in the death camp for helping other inmates on their legal cases. And she had no phone calls, no email, no mail. And finally, I think it was a month, and they gave her a chance to call. And when she called, she was angry. And I was saying, well, I'm speaking, I don't know, Upper J, someplace in upstate New York. And I says, what should I say? And she says, talk about corruption. The whole American and the world society is totally corrupt. And we of the people allow it to happen and don't point our finger directly at these corrupt people. The unions, it's a whole, like a plague. And it is a plague of corruption. And she says, give it to them about corruption and then mention my name at the end. Well, it is true that we live in a totally corrupt society, and we have to speak out about that. We have to say...
Well, I don't think anybody's afraid of speaking out. The problem is it's so endemic. It's so every place. It's not just a few people, you know, every once in a while. It's everybody all the time trying to get over.
True enough. And we see the end result. We think it's bad today, it's going to get worse. Mm-hmm. But there is a method. If we begin to support those who supported us, those people, and I must remind you, we all of us have been lied to, and many of us have accepted the lie. Malcolm X would say, you've been bamboozled. The sociologists would say, a metaphysical imperialist. And I say, all it is when good people hear the lie and believe it, we are doomed. And I'm going to talk about somebody that many of you love.
I'm going to interrupt because we want to give people a chance to ask some questions.
I will give people a chance.
I just want to say, this is Jaleel Montekin's book, Imprisoned in Attica. I'm tired on the way here. This is a person who's, as I say, an elder statesman of our movement, and he's up for parole, and he's asking people to write letters. It's not a whole lot to do. Sign a petition, not a whole lot to do. Go in, on the internet to the Jericho, either Jericho US or New York Jericho, because it's really worth doing.
Give me a minute to conclude. One of the things that we've all been lied about, and
two,
is a gentleman who was a good gentleman, a nice gentleman, but didn't understand. And I'm talking about Martin Luther King. Good gentleman, nice gentleman. And they always use the phrase Gandhi. He used Gandhi, no way. Because Gandhi started with 33 people, and 15 of them were revolutionaries. He had no problem with that. And he said to those who carried guns, never put down your guns because the British will slaughter us all. But I'm trying to organize the people who cannot and will not pick up arms to not to buy a pin from anything made from Britain. And so he was organizing people who couldn't do anything else. And he had no problem with people who could do something else, and his dictum that never put down your guns, because if you do, the British will slaughter us all. And I see that the public school system, which we prided ourselves in America, becomes privatized. Everything is becoming privatized, and there doesn't seem to be any fight back. And so what must we do? We must defend our political prisoners. We must bring them home so that the young people can say, hey, they fought. Many a lawyer had come up to me while Lynne was in prison and say, I went to law school because of what she did. Well, I used to say, and they would say, I want to be exactly like her. And I say, don't be exactly like her, because she ended up in prison. And now she's home, I can say, be exactly like Lynne. Organize people around you, have defense teams, and bring them all home. What's the call, as Chairman Fred Hampton says, free them all. And if we don't do that, the juggernaut of the corporation is going to crush us. And dare I say, we deserve it. Bring our political prisoners out of these death camps and have them come here and sit before you and have them talk about letters that you wrote to them, letters that you attacked Congress people, your local minister who has a problem with all acts. Tell them to be like Gandhi. Do what it is that you can do. Thank you for your time.
Point about corruption. There was an article last weekend in the Buffalo News regarding union membership and supporters of Trump, and it turns out in Buffalo, Western New York, 58% of union members support Trump. 57% of non-union working families support Trump. So the curious thing is, here's working people supporting Trump, and Verizon's out on strike asking for my support. I won't give it to them. School. I support the principal, I support the issues, but I ain't going out and marching in support of Trump, period.
Well, I think a statement that was made by a worker, and he said, I don't care if Trump is a racist, as long as he brings one steel mill back. And he's not going to bring a steel mill back.
No.
Well, that's right.
But you see how we've been misled to believing nonsense. But 50 years ago, there were political prisoners now dying in the death camps who said, soon America will become ungovernable. We may be at that point. And more important, we must save those minds who told us this 50 years ago and 40 years ago.
Just a quick reply to your comment is the CWA actually did protest Donald Trump. I don't know who they're endorsing exactly, but I was there at the protest.
They
endorsed Sanders. Yeah, there you go. CWA is the Union of Brothers.
I realize that.
Okay. But they're nurses union too.
Yeah.
Oh yes, that's right.
But if you notice the picket lines, you won't see a Trump sign on it, but by God, those sure do look like the people that were down at HSBC Arena when Trump was here.
Yeah.
And I don't mean to be stereotypical, but by God, I disagree with you.
Disagree with me on what?
No, him.
Oh,
not you.
Yeah.
No, it is very, and I remember going to a union meeting, and I think there are people here as old as I am.
No.
Stop.
But I remember my first union meeting. It was in a street in Western Pennsylvania that was, we didn't even call it integration. There were just a few black families among the workers. And they were proud to be workers. And my father said, I'm taking the youngest to a union meeting. No, I'm going to make it short. Anyway, my mother said, you can't go. You have to prove that you're able to run. And so I got held onto my father's pants at 5 and ran down the street. And when we got to the end of the block, the neighborhood came out and cheered. because they were proud to be workers and they had another union member. But the significance of that was if you went to a union meeting, you could be beaten. They had the thugs come out and the police, and they would go to the homes of the wives of the union members and attack them. And Jimmy Venaris, first,
don't get into that.
Anyway, that's the way it was.
His mother, while his father was out at a union meeting, would carry a 45 as she read them the evening paper. I mean, the 40, because she knew how dangerous it was. And so, self-defense is a wonderful thing.
And we must recognize it. Go ahead.
I like what you said. I think what you're saying, you didn't say explicitly, was that what's most important is that we're all workers, and the fact that you're black and I'm white is important, but can be used to divide us. And I think Hillary's using that very well in her campaign, promoting, you know, minority rights, gay and lesbian rights, and making everybody think of themselves like that instead of what we all have in common. And so we won't unify and struggle together.
We were just talking today with some folks about, you know, one of the big things they had to overcome in the prisons was the fact that there are so many gangs in the prison, if they're a microcosm of the bigger society, the wardens and the authorities know very well how to pit the various groups against each other. The Chicanos are going to fight the blacks, are going to fight the Aryans, are going to fight, and how was George Jackson's great insight, one of the reasons he was killed, and then we had another ex-pant that was telling us that he was also in prison when they were able to overcome that by just getting people to understand everybody's wearing the same khaki uniform, you're just another person, and the same with workers, just as you say. We're all that, and we're all really in this together. Yes.
I just want to say thank
my
you.
My correspondent.
thanks for coming out. It's just really inspirational to see you both here. You guys are together, and you're struggling through so much, and like, you know, a lot of people have legitimate reasons to have problems and not be able to do certain things. But you guys, in spite of everything, you're able to go. It's just really inspiring to see, and you know, the continuity of your message. it's so clear and resounding. It's like it's unwavering. It's super powerful. And I thank you guys for coming here and doing everything you do and continuing this. And you know, I think about retirement or things like that. And I really don't, you know, there's a time and a place, but I just see you guys are just inspiring. I'm glad. Robert Seth Hayes, who we visit a lot, you know, he said, you know, revolution is a process. And it really stuck with me. And you know, it's just like, yeah, it's not, he's like, even if there was a revolution, then the biggest amount of work would then happen because we have to figure out how to live in, like, you know, with the earth and with each other in a way that actually, you know, then, you know.
You know, anyway, the old story about the Sandinistas, unfortunately, I fear it may have been true because of what has transpired, but after they got rid of Somoza, they marched into Nicaragua to great cheers and cavalcades and et cetera. They got into the presidential palace. They looked at each other and said, what do we do now?
Yeah.
What do we do now?
Well, this is the first
question. That's a real issue, you know? How do you take the gains and make them real, make them real?
Well, what you have to do is...
Oh, you know what to
say. Say it, but do it. How do we come together? Prove it. That you can be together. We support all political prisoners, earth firsters, whatever, the people who are into animal rights, the people who are into gay rights. Hey, you're a political prisoner, and we are together on that. And I'll say a final note, we were in church the other day, and we're not theists, we're not Christians or Muslims, we just go for the camaraderie in a church that has been very active for 50, 60 years.
Very supportive,
very
of me during this whole thing.
And so there was a celebration of the 50th wedding anniversary of a couple, a very active couple who had been in the church. And somebody shouted out when they were cutting the cake, they were married 50 years and didn't have one argument. And then I shouted out and I said, not to worry, Lynn and I made up the number. And so, as you can see, we do make it up, but we have a belief.
We were overly impressed by the little red bird. Dare to struggle, dare to win.
And we have struggled.
I'm being funny, do you get it?
Yes, we have struggled, and we prove it by our lives. This is the way people have to do it. And, you know, it's race is other people's problem. Religion, that belongs to somebody else. Sex, that's somebody else's problem. It's not our problem. And we show it. And so, this is what we say to the world. We're not going to tell you, we're going to show you what
sex
we think
is correct. Sex is not our problem? I can resist it.
Yes.
Okay. Thank you, Buffalo.
I like your. I just love the fact that you're here and doing this work. And you mentioned something about taking back the school boards and the control of our schools, and it's such a big issue here in Buffalo. And I'm helping out, working on a campaign for a woman that's running for a school board for my district. Her name is Jen McCosey. Just encourage everybody to get out on, what is it, May 10th?
May 3rd.
And to get out and vote. It makes a big difference. Not only anybody comes out to vote in a presidential election, but for school board, it's much less. So your vote really counts if you can get out there and vote for her. We're trying to take it back from a capitalist guy, Carlo Paladino. So
thanks for being here. Extremely important.
All right, everybody, I know a bunch of people came in late, so the hat's up here if anyone wants to make a contribution. Again, this is a really special day that we got here, so give them another round of applause.
Burning Books is a place where these movements come together and gather and help each other grow and support each other. It's your contributions that make this happen. So I'm going to pass around this hat. Please make a contribution if you can.